This is the Backun Model Q low C bass clarinet. Probably one of the most highly anticipated bass clarinets in my memory, at least. Now, I met Mori about 20, 25 years ago. And when I first met him, when we first started working together, all he was doing was making barrels, and I think he had just started making bells. And he said to me, I'm going to make you a bass clarinet, and I'm going to start with the bell, and I'm going to move up from there. Well, 25 years later, he has finally moved all the way up from the bell to a full-fledged bass clarinet, which is the Model Q, and it comes in Grenadilla, which is what I'm holding here, and it comes in Cocobolo as well. And then there's a model with Grenadilla that has gold posts in it as well. But I just have the Grenadilla with silver keys, and I have the Cocobolo with silver keys. And oh, what a bass clarinet this is. Now, in full disclosure, I had a little bit of input into this bass clarinet, and I feel very fortunate to have been able to suggest things like key shapes, because I play standing up a lot, and, you know, some of the shapes of the keys were not comfortable for those of us who do play standing up, certainly if we play standing up with a strap. So anyway, he's taken a lot of those, and I think most of them, actually, into account, and they're building them into the final production instruments. What you see here is the third prototype and the second prototype. And I played the first prototype back in September, and these are the last prototypes before they go into actual production, I believe. Maybe there will be one more, but they're going to be going into production soon because they're going to start delivering in March or April. So, with all of that said, this is, like I said, a highly anticipated instrument, and I am certain that a lot of you are extremely curious about it, especially at the price point, which I should get out of the way right away. This bass clarinet is under $9,000. This bass clarinet is around $11,000. So for a $9,000 bass clarinet, you might think, well, maybe that's a mid-level bass clarinet. Well, I will show you in all of the ways that it is not a mid-level bass clarinet, and in fact, it eclipses a lot of the bass clarinets that are currently on the market in so many important ways. So without further ado, let's get started talking about the Backun Model Q bass clarinet. All right, so first of all, Mori will fully admit that he's looked at other bass clarinets and he has sort of taken notes on the things that he thinks make sense and some of the things that he wanted to change. So a lot of folks might look at this instrument and recognize parts of it that were on a Selmer or parts of it that were on a Buffet. For example, the keys right here, which are the trill keys, are on a pivot rather than a big long key that flaps open and close. That is a Selmer thing, if you want to call it that, and I love the fact that Mori made these pivots rather than long keys because long keys can bend and pivots generally do not bend. Now, people from Buffet might say, oh, well, there's a hole in the bell. I recognize that. Well, yes, that's true. A Buffet, Prestige, and Tosca, and some of the other instruments on the market do have a hole in the bell, which gives it a certain sound when you play it. So it's more robust than a Selmer, which is a little bit more covered. So there are elements of all of these in this instrument, but because Mori himself is a bass clarinet player, maybe you didn't know that, he started with that and then he completely departed. And some of the innovations on this instrument are unique to this instrument. Let me tell you about a few of them. Undercut tone holes are something that many of you are familiar with. What that means is that the tone hole is not just a chimney that goes all the way from the top of the instrument through into the bore of the instrument, but it actually has a flare on the inside of the instrument. And the reason that that is done by manufacturers is to improve the 12ths on the clarinets and bass clarinets. Now, what most manufacturers do is they undercut the front, the top, if you will, and the rear of each of these tone holes, but Mori undercuts it 360 degrees. So it's basically a flare all the way out into the instrument, every single key. So because of this undercut, the 12ths on this instrument are insanely in tune. Now, I will fully admit that I am not always the most in tune player, but this instrument does so much to make it easier. So let me show you some of the 12ths that are typically incredibly out of tune. Spot on in tune. If there's a little bit of variance, blame it on me, not on the instrument. So we've talked about 12ths, and these 12ths, all of them, all the way up and down, are in tune. Let's look at things like, 15ths, so we can see what two octaves sound like. It's totally nuts. So that's what undercutting is and what undercutting does. But what is overcutting? Well, let's take a close look at this instrument here. You will notice that every tone hole on the instrument has this bevel on the top and on the bottom of it. And there's an acoustic reason for it. It's not just pretty wings on the holes here. If you think about it, when you play a note like an F, the sound doesn't come out of the bell, maybe a little bit of it does, but the sound comes out of the holes below it. So this air is escaping those holes, and that is the resonance that you are hearing. That's also the first thing you notice when you're articulating something, is how easy it is. And that rough edge of each of the pad cups is something that is not efficient. But in the past, we've never done anything about it except add resonators to pads. Here, this bevel gives the air an off-ramp to get out from under the pad, and so the pad itself is not creating any turbulence in the air. Now, I know this sounds like voodoo, but it has an enormous impact on things like articulation and response of the instrument, especially in the clarion register. Here, listen. Those are normally very difficult notes to get to come out without grunting or squeaking. They're the butt clench notes of the bass clarinet. I think most of us will agree, especially when we have to play something like. This also assists us, bass clarinet players, when we have to play at extreme volumes. No grunting, no squeaking, no butt clenching. And also loud volumes, it doesn't spread and it doesn't chiff or chaff or whatever the right word is. It just pops right out. It's super, super clean. So that's what the overcutting of the tone holes does. So it's not just pretty, it actually has an effect. Another thing that Backun has done, and I was mentioning this earlier, which is taking some of the other features of bass clarinets that are on the market and incorporating and or improving on them. One of them is this third register key here, which is just for the throat B flat. Now, the Buffet Tosca has this, but most of the other instruments that I've seen don't have it. What it does is it allows that B flat to be in tune, but it also allows this other register key to shift slightly so the 12ths are in tune and they speak better. So this dedicated B flat doesn't just make the B flat better, it makes the notes above the B flat better. Here, let me play the side B flat here with the trill key, which most of us do when we want to have a good sounding B flat, and I will then play the throat B flat. Both of those have a very similar timbre, are basically the same intonation, and the throat B flat in particular is just not fuzzy. So that's another great benefit to having this third register key, if you want to call it that, for the throat B flat. Now, like I said, I don't have just one bass clarinet here. This is the model Q in Cocobolo. And Cocobolo is a different wood with different characteristics and different hardnesses and all of that stuff. And so, the question you might have is, what's the difference? Which one would I want if I was going to pick one of these bass clarinets up? So let's talk about the difference in sound between Grenadilla and Cocobolo. One thing I should mention to you is that a microphone that's 5 feet away from me, or certainly me sitting behind the instrument, you're gonna feel a certain difference between the two, but it is really something that you're gonna wanna hear out in a hall. Once you get 20 feet away from this instrument and the acoustics of the space, and the instrument kind of develops its sound out into the space, it is a very, very different experience than sitting in front of it or right behind it. It's one of those things you're gonna have to trust me on. In general, Grenadilla has a more focused sound. The further out you get, it stays focused. The Cocobolo has a little bit of a softer edge to it. It's a little rounder, a little warmer sounding. And you'll hear the difference even up close here. So let me play something on the Grenadilla, and then I will play the same thing on the Cocobolo so you can maybe hear the difference. Now, remember, this is the difference 5 feet from me through a microphone through YouTube. It is not the difference in a hall. So enough disclaimers. Here's a little more Bach. Actually hear the difference sitting behind it. I think you might be able to hear it too. I don't know how else to describe it, but the Cocobolo has a warmer sound, I think. Certainly sitting behind it, it feels more warm and squishy and it's than the Grenadilla does, which has more of a direct sound. And like I was saying, it's a more focused sound. So whether the Grenadilla or the Cocobolo is appropriate for your particular use case is obviously not something that I can say, but you know, that's a starter for your information about what you might find if you were to pick up one versus the other. And last but not least, the case. Backun worked with Marcus Bona, and any of you who know me know that I'm a huge fan of Bona cases. I have them, I sell them, but they're not as small as this case. This case actually is about the size of a violin case, and it holds the entire bass clarinet inside this little case, so it will fit on any overhead. But it also has this really nice little feature here, which allows you to take a heavy bass clarinet stand that obviously won't fit in the case and put it on top of the case. And there are straps in the top and the bottom that will hold the bass clarinet stand firmly against the case so that you can strap it on your back and you can carry it without any concern for the stand falling off. Now, inside the case are some typical Marcus Bona features that I like so much, namely that it holds the bass clarinet up elevated off of the case itself so the keys don't bang into the sides of the case or each other. Just simply put, when you have an instrument that has keys that are not touching the sides of it, they spend less time getting bent out of shape or requiring adjustment at your repair shop. So, very thoughtful case here that comes included with the Model Q. Now, I figure you all have heard me talk enough. You're here to hear what this bass clarinet sounds like and not what I sound like. So let me play a few different types of pieces that you might encounter playing a bass clarinet, like an excerpt or a solo piece or maybe even a little jazz, just so you know you might be able to hear it in an environment that you might be playing it in. So I'll play a few things so that you can hear them. I'll start on the Cocobolo so you can hear a little bit more of that. So in summary, what do I think? Well, I think this is probably the best bass clarinet I have ever played. It is the most in-tune bass clarinet I've ever played, period. It is one of the most easy to play bass clarinets, period. It feels great. The keywork itself is really, really gorgeous. It's quiet. It feels very, very sturdy. The options of the Cocobolo and Grenadilla are certainly something that you can decide for yourself. I think I would probably go for the Cocobolo, or I might just go for both of them because they have different characteristics. I suppose if I can afford to buy two of them for the cost of one of the other professional bass clarinets that I play, maybe I could afford two of them. So that's certainly a ridiculous, but I suppose, feasible option. So I am just enormously excited about this instrument. As I mentioned before, I'm a little bit biased because I had some input into it. But for that matter, I think the input hopefully was well taken, and it is a comfortable instrument to play, which is important to me. It's an easy instrument to play, and it's an in-tune instrument to play, which is important to everybody. So I cannot recommend this instrument enough. It is such a great value, and I hope all of you have found this to be useful. If you have any comments, I'm sure that you will put them in the comment section below. And if you have any questions or comments for me, please head over to Earspasm and send me a note from there. I'd love to hear from you. In the meantime, happy holidays. Enjoy your families and friends, stay healthy, and we will see you next year.